way, Constantine.
Thank you very much. Yeah, so I'm going to address the topic of the common refugees in the sedentary world. Do you hear me well?
Yes, very well.
Yeah, great, great. And I will try to draw some conclusions on the basis of certain comparative examples and perspectives. So first and foremost, let's just have some general introduction into what the Kuman-Kipchak tribal community was at the moment the Mongol expansion started. It was a great tribal community that wasn't united in a single confederation, not to speak of a state at all. So polycentric, politically multi-centric structure that was predominant among the Kuman-Kipchak tribes. And we got them occupying huge territory in contemporary Central Asia and in what is today's Eastern Europe, like Southern Ukraine and Southern Russia. So what was very typical for them was the fact that they were living into the steppe and were rather reluctant to leave the steppe for a longer periods of time. So they were very much interested into participating in campaigns into the sedentary world, but weren't really interested in settling outside the steppe. They were very happy with the place they possessed, with the steppes they occupied. And that's why we can say that in this particular case, the theoretical framework of Professor Khazanov is very suitable about the nomads in the outside world. So the Kuman-Kipchaks used to settle to live permanently in the steppe core in the nomadic inland and interacted dynamically with the outside world, but weren't really interested in settling in it before the Mongols came, unless we don't count few exceptional cases. So this is just to have an idea, general idea of the huge space occupied by the Kuman-Kipchak tribes. There was no state of the Kuman-Kipchaks as it is written here. It's just a rough picture, rough idea. It doesn't also mean that all this territory was occupied entirely and only by the Kuman-Kipchak. It means that they were all these territories were mainly dominated by the Kuman-Kipchak tribes that were Turkic speakers, I should say. So the Mongol conquests in Deshti Kipchak, they started already in the first or the at the term between the first and the second decade of the 13th century, with the first clashes being mainly in Central Asia and are poorly documented in the mainly in the Chinese sources in the Yangtze. Later on, there was the famous campaign that led to the battle at the Khalkha River, which was in 1223, but which didn't produce that much influx of refugees. And then we got the Great Western Campaign that ended up into Hungary, which produces the biggest influx of Kuman-Kipchak refugees into the sedentary world, at least if we are speaking about Europe. So what is really interesting and important is that it seems that the Kuman-Kipchak tribes that were living around Volga were able to hold on for a while the Mongol pressure until 1236-1237, when the united armies of the more than 12 Chinggis delivered a crushing blow on this front side. So they made the breakthrough through the Volga, and this was, we can say, the beginning of the end of the independent Deshti Kipchak in Eastern Europe. So this was the beginning of the Mongol conquest in the European parts of Deshti Kipchak, the Asian parts being conquered earlier on. So the final conquest of Deshti Kipchak was brought, of course, in the next few years, in 1238, 1239, perhaps. And these are the years that witnessed the biggest influx of nomadic refugee waves into the surrounding sedentary states. Then we get the campaign in Hungary, which is, of course, very much commented on here on this conference. And and I should say that perhaps there was it wasn't the last event that led to spread of Kuman-Kipchak refugee waves around. I think there were even later refugee waves that were still moving. Moving on from the steppe, even in the years afterwards. So I would say the most important factor in witnessing this huge influx of refugees, Kuman refugees, was the so-called Mongol terror, which is described both in Western sources and in Eastern sources. And it is very interesting, should be studied better. So I will just bring your attention to sources that I have been shown even before, but still I find them very useful. So this is from a letter from between Western European nobles that are commanding on the course of the Mongol advance. So they mentioned that the Kumans that are fighting men, they couldn't stand against the Mongols in their own land, but they were forced to move to the Christian lands, and that's where 20,000 Kumans, of course these numbers are just figurative, and they entered into a union with the Christians and are ready to fight against every other nation except the aforementioned Mongols. So the Kumans are ready to provide their military services to everybody against everybody, but they are not really willing to face the Mongols again. I think that's, and we have this rhetoric question, and what is to be wondered here? Then we got a Persian source describing the Khwarezmian refugees in Anatolia, which is actually presenting very much the same picture. So describing the sudden defeat of a huge 40,000 man strong group of Khwarezmian refugees from at the hands of 700 Mongols. A witness of the whole battle says that if a head, a Mongol head, is thrown between thousands of Khwarezmian horsemen, they will immediately just disperse, and the Almighty God has settled such a fear, such a Mongol fear, in the heart of the Khwarezmians that one cannot even describe it. So here one should also mention that Khwarezmians were part of the Eastern Kuman Kipchak tribes that were serving under the Khwarezm Shahs and were later on forced to move into the Middle East by the Mongol invasion. So here we witness the same phenomenon of the Mongol fear, which was of course very well attested into other societies as well. But for the Kumans, I think it was very, very peculiar. So it's just a small map where the green dots would point the places where there were massive refugee waves into Western Eurasia. The red dots will signify place where we have knowledge of certain individuals that were able to integrate themselves into the neighboring societies, just as a separate individuals or small groups. And the yellow dot is just the Mamluks that were sold off, Kuman Kipchak slaves that were sold off as military slaves. And let's come to the topic of the Kuman Kipchak refugees in Bulgaria. So first, one would be surprised. I was actually surprised to find out that perhaps Bulgaria is the place where we have the biggest number of documented separate Kuman Kipchak waves. These are other three separate cases that are documented. I believe there were many more that were not documented. First one of them is described by Acropolis around 1237, and also by other Byzantine authors. And I think Professor Nikolov will speak more about this tomorrow, so I won't intrude into his topic. But what is important is that this wave, it came directly from the steppes through the Danube, crossed the Danube, and then continued for the strategical regions of Thrace. From there onward, crossing through Bulgarian territories, later on these refugees found asylum in the Latin Empire and further on into Nicaea. Then we have Master Roger describing the Mongol invasion in Hungary in 1241, who says that after the assassination of Kuten and his family, most of the Kumans gathered together and left Hungary for Bulgaria. So they left for Bulgaria. And then we have a few other sources that say that Cumans came back in 1246. Perhaps most of them came back from Bulgaria. So we can assume that the biggest part of Cretan's followers spent these 5 years between 1241 and 1246 in Bulgaria. And then we have one not that very famous source, Ibn Taghribidi, who had preserved parts of Sultan Baybars' biography. Sultan Baybars is a Mamluk of Kipchak origin who apparently witnessed the Mongol invasion. So that's why it's important for us. And it is a very interesting case since it apparently describes migration from the steppes into Bulgaria through the sea, perhaps with ships. But we will come back in a few minutes on that issue. So this is Baybars grouping. It's it says the same in Bulgarian on the top of it. And this is the part of the English translation Professor Korobeynikov provided of this part of the Arabic biography of Baybars. So the reason for his Baybars move from his homeland to other countries was the Tatars. When the Tatars decided to go to the Kipchak's land in 639 year of Hijra, which corresponds to 1241, 1242, and the news reached them, the Kipchaks, the letter wrote to Anas Khan, the King Malik of Valacia, that they were going to cross the Sea of Sudak, which is the Black Sea, in order to come to him so that he would grant them asylum from the Tatars. And he positively replied to them on the request and settled them in the valley between two mountains. And their travel to him took place at the next year, 640 of Hijra, which corresponds to 1242, 1243. However, when the peaceful life in that location meant them quiet, he perfidiously acted, this is the Valacian ruler, against them and made a fierce attack on them. And he killed some of them and took others into captivity. Baysari said, I, as well as Malik al-Zahir, which is Baybars, were among those captured. And he said, and at that time, he, Baybars, was about 14 years old. And here, Professor Korobeynikov have identified the Valacian as the Second Bulgarian Empire on the basis of many other similar accounts, both in the Western sources, some Byzantine sources, and also the Arabic sources, the Mamluk sources. And the Anas Khan, he supposed it may be a kind of slightly corrupted form of the Asen Khan, which would designate some of the Asenid rulers of the Second Bulgarian Empire. I believe this is very acceptable, very much acceptable. I think it's a very good interpretation. So can we place all this information, short as it is, into the Eurasian context and try to explain what were the reasons for the perfidious actions, perfidious of the anonymous Valacian ruler. First of all, we should say that at every place where we have influx of significant Cuman Kipchak refugee waves, we get a change of the power balance. This is due to the fact that the Cuman had significant military potential that could change the balance of the local political factors. So it was very important for the local players to try to attract these refugee hordes and to employ them for their own political plans, which was actually the case with King Bela IV in Hungary. And this is what also happened in Hungary. We got a change of the power balance, but it was within Hungary between the king and the nobility. We also have, at least that's what we see in Master Rogers' account, we have a tension on everyday basis between the refugees, the nomadic refugees with all their livestock that they're bringing with them, and the local peasantry and the local agriculturalists. And we also have a very important feature of the behavior of the Cuman Kipchaks. Everywhere we have them in the surrounding sedentary territories in Eurasia. So it's extreme opportunism, which is of course motivated by the fear of the Mongols, the Mongol terror, and uncontrolled behavior of these tribal groups. We got this very well attested in Thrace. in the years between 1237 and 1241. We got that for another Kipchak refugee wave in Transcaucasia, which moved there in 1221, 1222. And it was very indicative because they were trying to move their loyalty to and to offer it to each of the leading political factors in Transcaucasia, starting with the Georgians and then moving to the Muslims and some local rulers as well. So in the end, all the local players unified and destroyed the newcomers because they were in a way threat for the established status quo. And we got this also in the Holy Land with the Khwarezmian refugees that were devastating the region in the 30s and the 40s of the 13th century, and were also offering their military services to the Ayyubids and to their allies, also Christian allies, also the Franks. So in the end, they were changing sides until the moment that they were defeated in 1248, if I remember correctly, by one of their last employers, the ruler of Egypt, since they turned to be completely uncontrolled and their military potential was unpredictable. So when we come to what they had to offer and what was also dangerous for the perspectives of integration of the Kuman Kipchak refugees in the sedentary world, we would say that they got the political know-how, how the local sedentary factors function, because they had attended the region before while they were offering their services as allies and mercenaries before the advent of the Mongols. They had this significant military potential, and they had the desperate opportunism that they had to carve a niche for themselves. So if we come back to the distort refugee wave in Bulgaria and the title of this particular presentation, Crime and Punishment, I believe that the reasons for the perfidious actions of the Valachian rulers was that he delivered the blow against these refugees due to the fact that he was suspicious towards their behavior, that they were going to move their military potential to some of his allies or some of his neighbors, excuse me, which was actually the case with the previous refugee wave that entered Bulgaria just a few years earlier. So apparently the anonymous Bulgarian ruler was willing to check this danger. And the only question that we cannot answer, of course, this is just an interpretation, but I cannot answer the question whether he did that as a kind of preventive blow, or he did it because he already had certain indications that his guests will move to one of his adversaries. Thank you very much for your attention.